Hey, Katie.
Hey.
Thanks for taking the time to hang out with us today.
Of course. I'm so excited to be here.
Now, you're getting your PhD here at MIT CCL. What inspired you to work at the intersection of machine learning and mental health?
I was initially drawn to machine learning because I think it's really interesting from an intellectual standpoint. And then I quickly grew even more interested when I realized the immense potential it has to make a societal impact. And I think one area that is particularly ripe to have an impact in is mental health, because a lot of people struggle with mental health, and compared to other aspects of health, like physical health, our understanding is relatively limited.
I completely agree. Now, for those of us not in the field, can you walk me through the challenge of accurately capturing mental health metrics using machine learning?
Yeah, let me talk through an example. So some of my work has looked at how we can automatically monitor mental health from speech data. You can imagine that when someone's depressed, it changes the way they speak. They may speak more slowly and in a more monotone manner. And so we can use machine learning to pick up on those changes. The main challenge is that other things also change speech, such as how tired someone is, who they're speaking to, what recording device is being used. And so we have to disentangle between these various factors.
Now, what specific mental health conditions are you focusing on?
I've worked on speech data from people with bipolar disorder. I've also worked on wearable sensor data that we've collected from people who have depression. And then finally, I've looked at stress and anxiety.
You've been at this for about 5 years. So how do you see personalized interventions improving mental health care in, say, the next decade?
One of the big challenges with mental health care is that the best treatment for one individual can be different from the best treatment for another individual. And it's hard to know which treatment works best in advance. So machine learning can be used to help understand interpersonal differences to enable more tailored treatments.
Now, to deploy these models in the real world, we always hope that they're safe and accurate, but how do we ensure that? And do you have any ethical concerns?
Absolutely. I think when we think about deploying machine learning-based health technology, we need to consider how we evaluate other types of healthcare interventions like medications. We should apply the same scrutiny when considering whether we should use mental health technology on patients.
Absolutely. Now, a big part of research is dealing with difficult challenges all day long and trying to solve them. So tell us about something particularly challenging that you solved.
Yeah, so a problem we see time and time again when working with mental health data is that when we visualize the data, so say we have speech here on the x-axis and heart rate on the y-axis, the data is highly clustered by individual. So here we have person one, and over here we have person two. And these interperson differences are so pronounced that it can make it hard to determine the differences we actually care about, which are within individuals. So when is this person depressed versus not? And so I develop algorithms that allow us to better focus on the differences we care about and ignore these other differences that make it difficult to learn.
That does sound challenging. Now, do you have a favorite software or tool that's indispensable to your work?
One tool I've liked a lot recently is called Weights and Biases. It allows me to automatically track the progress of my experiments and visualize the results in real time.
Oh, hi, Katie.
Oh my gosh, hi, Omina.
So good to see you.
You too.
So to put this in really simple terms, can you explain the role of causal inference as if I was a 10-year-old?
Sure. So causal inference is a field that studies cause and effect. And it's important to distinguish causal relationships from those that are just correlations. For instance, if I take vitamins, I want to know if they will actually improve my health versus they're just something that healthy people do, so they're correlated with health.
Oh yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So can you explain the role of causal inference as it pertains in your research on machine learning and health?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we use machine learning to, for instance, recommend treatments to patients, we need to make sure that the relationships we're considering are causal relationships, that the treatment will actually have a causal effect on the patient's health and isn't just something that the machine learning model has picked up as co-occurring with better health.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Of course. Good to see you.
You too. Hope you have a great day.
You too.
So a big part of research is balancing the theoretical with the practical. How do you do that?
I like to use the practical challenges that we encounter when thinking about mental health applications to motivate my more general machine learning work.
Now, what about limitations to current approaches to mental health monitoring? How does your work address those?
One of the main limitations is that monitoring right now is restricted primarily to observations of patients in the clinic. My work examines how we can use data from patients outside of the clinic as they go about their everyday lives to get a more comprehensive picture of health.
Could you talk to me about what you find to be the most fulfilling aspect of your work?
There are a couple of things. First is the people. I get to work with brilliant, motivated, just wonderful people. And then the second is that I'm constantly challenging myself and learning new things.
Do you have any current favorite applications of ML in healthcare?
Obviously, I'm excited about mental health care, but in addition to that, I'm also really excited about machine learning for helping people improve their physical fitness.
With all these wearables, I do tend to think about navigating privacy concerns that are inherent in using AI for health monitoring.
Definitely, that's a really important thing that we think about. There's many ways we consider privacy. One is making sure we have great security practices. Another is making sure we only collect the data we need. And then finally, we also make sure that we're transparent with the people's whose data we're collecting and we obtain informed consent.
Over the past couple years, we've had increasingly more conversations around mental health and therapy. So how do you see the integration of these AI tools in mental health care changing societal perceptions?
Incorporating AI in mental health care can help make it more accessible. And I think in doing so, that will help to reduce the stigma around accessing mental health care.
When you lie awake at night, do any philosophical questions come up considering the role of AI in understanding human emotions?
One question that comes up is, what does it even mean to experience an emotion? AI may be able to simulate having an emotion, but does that mean it really experiences emotions?
What about the balance between human empathy and machine precision playing out in mental health interventions?
I think we definitely need both, and I don't think they necessarily need to be in tension. If we equip mental health professionals to improve their ability to help patients using machine learning tools, I think we can have both.
And what about this potential future relationship between human therapists and AI in mental health care?
Yeah, I think mental health care workers are already using AI tools to help, for instance, summarize clinical notes. And I think we'll see this continue into the future, where AI is used to enhance the ability of therapists and other mental health care professionals to do their jobs.
Oh, hey, Katie.
Hey, Gabe.
Can you tell me about a moment in your research that changed your understanding of machine learning's potential?
Yeah, so actually when I first started doing research, I worked on a project where we were detecting changes in the severity of bipolar disorder from speech data. And when I got my first model working, it was so exciting. And it really demonstrated to me how machine learning has this potential to help in really important applications.
Cool, thanks.
Yeah, of course. See you, Gabe.
You've been at this for a while. I've asked you a lot of questions about your research. So throughout all of this, how do you maintain a sense of curiosity and wonder, especially when things are complex or frustrating?
I think for me, a big part of it is recognizing that when challenges occur, that's where most of the learning lies. I've found that I've made some of my biggest breakthroughs at moments of peak frustration.
Now, since we're in a different building, I thought it'd be a great time to ask about life at MIT CSAIL. Tell me about your most memorable experience so far.
One of my most memorable experiences came early on when I was giving one of my first lab meeting presentations, and I found that within just a few slides of my presentation, I was stopped and asked so many questions. And I think that really reflects how engaged everyone is here. Everyone was so invested in helping me and offering suggestions. And that's really stuck with me.
Now, what about a typical day at CSAIL?
My days vary a lot. I do a number of different things, from coding to writing to preparing presentations to having brainstorming sessions, whiteboarding. So it really just depends on the project and the day, and I love the degree of flexibility that I have.
Yeah, like hanging out with us all day. Now, I know community is a really big part of research and it's a big part of the ethos at CSAIL. Talk to me about a collaboration that maybe brought a new perspective to your work.
So partway through my second year of my PhD, I started working closely with my friend and collaborator, Rob Lewis. And we worked on a number of different projects ranging from more applied in the mental health space to more general machine learning projects. And I've just loved having someone to go into the weeds with. We do a lot of brainstorming sessions together, and some of my most productive research moments have come through that collaboration. So it's something I've appreciated so much during my time here.
What's it like working with your advisors?
Working with my advisors is a wonderful experience. Not only are they brilliant, they're also incredibly supportive and engaged in my work. One thing I really admire about them is they both value doing really high quality technical work and making sure that the work has the potential for real world impact.
And how do you incorporate their feedback into your work?
That's a great question. I think about what the advice they've given me a lot as I'm going about my research week to week, but then I also have meetings each week with them where we discuss together how I can incorporate their feedback and thinking about what I'm going to do next.
Okay. Now, do you have a favorite spot on campus?
Yeah, I love going to the river, at the Charles River, and walking along it. I find it's a great way to clear my head, especially when I'm working on a difficult research problem.
It's beautiful and peaceful. Is that your favorite spot in Cambridge?
It's among them. I also am a big foodie, so I love this Mediterranean tapas restaurant called Oleana.
Oleana is amazing. If you are watching this and you haven't been, go. Now, what's your favorite aspect of living in Massachusetts?
I love that Massachusetts has a mix of everything I'd like. In a state, and Boston in a city, there's great food, there's fun breweries, there's pretty nature. Boston's a pretty city. And then on top of that, there's access to nature. I love skiing and hiking, and it's great that I can do both of those easily from here.
Let's rewind a bit and talk about life before MIT. Talk to me about your experiences at the University of Michigan.
I loved my time at the University of Michigan. I actually grew up in Ann Arbor, so the city is a really special place in my heart. And my time at the University of Michigan was so fun. I met so many of my best friends there. It has this really high energy culture that I love. And then the other thing about it is it's where I really cultivated my research interests. It's where I first started doing research on machine learning for mental health and first thought about applying to do my PhD, and so ultimately how I ended up at MIT.
Wow. All right. So what are some of the differences then between living in Michigan and Cambridge?
Well, I was hoping that when I moved to Cambridge, I would escape the Michigan winters and have better weather. That hasn't really turned out to be true. It's maybe a little bit better. But what I like about living in Cambridge is it feels like a bigger city than Ann Arbor, which is very much a college town. So there are more restaurants, more people, more going on.
Okay, so the bar is really low for weather in Boston. But anyways, I want to talk about your internships. I know you interned at Microsoft 3 times. Tell me a little bit about that.
I really liked my internships at Microsoft. The first 2 were in software engineering, and I was so excited because it was my first time working at a company in general. But what I didn't like as much is I felt like it was a little bit limited in terms of creativity. I was told to code things and then I'd code them. So I was actually very excited when I got to intern at Microsoft Research this past summer. I had much more freedom in terms of directing the course of the project and was able to work on cutting edge research.
Now, did any of that influence your current work? And either way, just tell me about some current published papers you're working on.
Yeah, so one recent paper was around detecting stress from a biosignal called electrodermal activity, which sounds scary, but really what that is, it's the electrical conductance of your skin, which has to do with how much you sweat. So when your fight or flight response is triggered, it changes sweat activity, and then we can actually measure that to track changes in stress.
The field is rapidly advancing. It sometimes feels like it's almost daily. So how do you stay current with new advancements?
It can be tough, but I find there's a few things that help me. One is Twitter. Academic Twitter has a lot of posts where people are sharing the latest advancements. And then I read a lot of papers. And then finally, I talk to people. I find it's helpful to know people who are in the know. So I'm always talking to other people about what they've been reading about.
How do you prioritize all of your tasks and just manage your time between research and your personal life?
It can be tough, but but I find what's important for me is scheduling things in my personal life, so I hold myself accountable to doing them. So I love playing soccer and I have regular soccer practice. I love running and I book time for that. And then I also make a lot of social plans with friends to get me out of the office.
Okay, so now can you share a book or a paper that's greatly influenced you?
Yeah, so off the top of my head, one book that's influenced my research a lot is called The Book of Why. It's by Judea Pearl and Dana McKenzie, and it's about causal inference and its importance.
What's it like to mentor students or new researchers who come to your lab?
Getting to mentor other students is one of my favorite parts about being a grad student. I find that it's so rewarding to get to pay it forward and help other people find the joys of research and gain the confidence in their ability to take on challenging research problems. Oh, hey, Rob.
Hey, Katie. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Good, good. It's great to see you. What are your aspirations for the next phase of your career?
I think a couple things come to mind. One is I would like to move more towards having a real impact on real patients. And then the other is I would like to continue to mentor students, and I would like to increase my scope in doing that and actually become a professor and have my own lab.
Those are all really admirable goals, and I'm sure you're going to get there. I have one last question for you. What advice would you give to aspiring young researchers who dream about getting to a position like yours?
I think one thing that's been really big for me has been reflecting on what my genuine interests are and following those. I think machine learning has gotten so hot and there's all these things like large language models that everyone's really excited about, and it's easy to get caught up in what other people are talking about. But it's important to think about what genuinely gets you excited and go for that. And then the second thing is to really go for it. I've found that by reaching out to people and expressing my interests and making connections, that's been huge for my success, because so much of my success comes from the people that I get to work with. It was good to see you, Rob. Nice hanging with you all. I'll see you next time. Take care.